in. Let us appreciate him for our going out and our coming in. That we are still on our feet. It's not because we are righteous. It's not because we are better than those that are sick or those that are dead. It's not because we are better than those that are in one problem or the other right now. It's because of his mercy. It's because of his compassion. Let us tell him how we feel about him. He's our helper. Daddy, you are better than the better. You are better than the best. You are glorious. You are wonderful. You are excellent. Father, there is none like you. You are my maker. You are my strength. You are the author and the finisher of my faith. Lord, I give you glory. I give you honor. I give you all adoration. Lord, I appreciate you. You are good. You are kind. You are glorious. Father, we bless you. Lord, we worship you. Lord, we exalt you. How excellent is your name, O Lord. How excellent is your name, O Lord. How excellent is your name. If you are there, let's read together. Truly, my soul is saved
from him.
Comes my salvation.
He alone,
is my rock and my salvation. He is my defense. I shall not be greatly moved. How long will he imagine mischief against man? Ye shall be snared of all of you. As a bowing wall shall he be, and as a tottering fence.
The only plan to trust him,
cast him down,
high position.
And the light,
He only is my rock and my salvation. My fortress, I shall not be shaken.
It's my defense, I shall not be shaken.
On God rest my salvation.
God is my salvation.
My mighty rock,
the rock of my strength.
And trust in him at all times, O people.
Trust in him at all times,
before him.
God is a refuge for him. God is a refuge for us.
Those of low estate,
men of low degree are vanity, and men of high degree are lying. To be laid in balance, they are altogether lighter than vanity. Trust not in oppression, and become not vain in robbing. If riches increase, set not your heart upon them. God has spoken once, twice I have heard. That all powers belong unto God. Also unto thee, O Lord, belongeth mercy, for thou renderest to every man according to his work. Amen. The Lord is my rock and my salvation. The rock is my glory, the rock of my strength, and the refuge is in God. to bless the one that has refuge for us. The Bible says, the righteous run into Jesus and they are saved. Let us thank him for provision of security, provision of safety. Let us appreciate him because everything that is happening around us, according to his word, he said, we only hear it. We will only see it. It will not be our own portion. Let's just appreciate him. Let's wave our hands and just tell him who he is. Father, we thank you. King of glory, we thank you. Everlasting Father, we thank you. Our defense, we thank you. Our teacher, we thank you. Our savior, we thank you. The Lord, we thank you. Father, we thank you. About thousands are falling on our right, 10,000 on our left. We only see with our eyes. Lord, we thank you for safety. We thank you for divine provision. We thank you for divine protection. We thank you for divine ideas. We thank you for understanding who you are. We thank you for what you have. We thank you, Lord, for what you are doing in our lives. Father, we thank you. Lord, we praise your name.
When the arrest was given against us, the woman of the Bahamas, the strength would have gone over our soul. We thank you tonight in Jesus' name that by your grace our soul has escaped as a bird out of the snare of the fowlers. My God, the snare is broken and we have escaped. And our help is in the name of the Lord, the maker of the heavens and the earth. We thank you tonight.
In Jesus' mighty name, we appreciate him.
Amen.
The Bible says, many are called, few are choosing. If today is the day, where will you be? It's not by number. A man of God, the Lord directs him to a compound, an old school compound, filled with bush, to go and preach. When he entered the place, there was no single soul. He looked around and he began to wonder, am I doing the right thing? The Spirit of the Lord said, deliver the message.
Hallelujah.
And the man preached. Unknown to him, there is somebody in one of the classrooms that is about to commit suicide. He preached to the empty school and he left. Some few years later, he was somewhere in the congregation. And one man came out, one of the senior pastors, came out to testify. And he said, I thank you because you saved my life. Then he began to wonder. He now reminded him, you are in one empty school on so-so date, so-so year. I was the one that the Lord sent you to. It's not by number.
Come on.
I'm telling you, Jesus Christ will not come for number. He's come for the few. He's coming for the few. Just say to the Lord, Father, I appreciate you because I'm among the few.
Thank you, Lord.
Whether the devil likes it or not, Father, no matter the criteria you want to use, I'm thanking you because you placed me among the few.
Not because of what I've done, but because of your mercy and grace. So tonight, I thank you that I'm counted, my God, among the few. I give you thanks tonight. In humility, I thank you, my God. I thank you because I'm not better than anybody. It is the grace of God that has kept me, for I am kept by the power of God. I thank you, Father. I give you the glory. I give you the glory. I give you all the glory. I thank you, my God. We thank you, my God. We thank you that we are among the few that, Lord, you have chosen. We thank you in Jesus' precious name. We thank you. Thank you, my God. We thank you.
In Jesus' name we pray.
Hallelujah.
Are you in the number? Are you in the number? Are you in the number? Saved by grace. Are you in the number? Are you in the number? Are you in the number? Saved by grace. I am in the number. I am in the number. I am in the number. Saved by grace, I am in the number, I am in the number, I am in the number, saved by grace. It's not the number of the people in the church. God is not interested.
Hallelujah.
We want to see crowd. We want to see crowd. God wants to see saints.
Come on.
There's difference between crowd and saints.
Amen.
Jesus did the work for 3.5 years, and he was able to gather just 120. But anywhere he is, there is multitude. The day God will bless, especially, you won't see crowd there, because it's not their day. It's not their day. Who are you looking for? Are you looking for man? Or you are looking for Jesus? I want you to tell the Lord, Father, you have saved me by your grace. Keep me in that grace. Don't allow me to stray away. Don't allow anything to take me out of you.
In the name of Jesus Christ, I pray, Father, tonight, in the name of Jesus Christ, that Lord, your grace will preserve me, but who says the grace in which we stand. I pray that I will remain in your grace. I pray that your grace, my God, will be the foundation of my life. Your grace will sustain me, my God. The grace
Lord, keep me, Lord, in grace, your grace. I refuse to receive your grace in vain.
Of Jesus Christ.
The Bible says many receive the grace of God in vain. Lord, I refuse to be among the many. I want to be among the chosen. Because your word says, many are called, few are chosen. Father, I want to be among the few. Let your grace keep me going. Let your grace open my eyes. Let your grace give me understanding. Let your grace speak on my behalf. Let your grace keep me whole. In the mighty name of Jesus.
Jesus' name, Jesus' name.
I refuse to follow crowd. I refuse to be among the multitude. Father, locate me, Lord. By your word is living. Locate me, Lord. Locate me for salvation afresh. Locate me for your divine touch. Locate me, Lord, for compassion. Father, locate me for purification. Locate me tonight for sanctification. Father, locate me, Lord. Locate me, Lord. Locate me, Lord. Remaseke de posoto maneke zendereboa. Mamama raposoto neke zenderea. Rami maneke zenderebo koshosia. Father, Lord, locate me. Holy Ghost, locate me. Daddy, I thank you because you are not watching out for numbers. Father, Lord, I thank you for bringing me here tonight. Lord, I thank you because your hand will touch me. It doesn't matter how many people are here. I will not go back home the same.
Jesus' name, in Jesus' name, in Jesus'
name. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. We are going to pray for our daddy that will minister to us this night. I'm going to tell him, Daddy, remove him completely. Hallelujah. And you appear.
Yes, Lord.
Use him to touch my life.
Jesus. Jesus' name.
Let today be the best of his ministration.
Hallelujah.
It doesn't matter. Hallelujah. The number.
Jesus.
The owner of the work is here.
Yes, Lord.
The Bible says you cannot come on your own. Those that are not here, it's not because they don't want to come. Is the people that the Holy Spirit want to draw. That is what the word of God says.
Hallelujah.
It says, except it draw you.
Except. Hallelujah.
Sam said it this way. He said, if the Lord did not build the house, they labor in vain that build it.
Oh, Jesus.
If this place is full, and our daddy minister, and no fly, no mosquito, give his life to Christ, and the world did not even move beyond this roof, it means he has wasted his time. Mm-hmm. But if he has only one, there is joy in heaven.
Hallelujah.
When you now go back and you begin to hear the testimony,
yes, Lord.
That man was in an empty school compound, abandoned property. Unknown to him, a great evangelist that the devil is about to waste is hiding there. About to hang himself to death.
Jesus. Hallelujah.
But the one that see beyond human, use him to save that man's life. We are going to tell the Lord tonight, Father, use your son to change my life.
Hallelujah. Jesus. Jesus be glorified tonight in the name of Jesus. Jesus be glorified tonight. Jesus be glorified tonight. Jesus be glorified tonight. Lord be glorified. We pray in Jesus, lifting our hearts before you. Lifting our hearts before you, my God. Lifting our hearts before you. In the name of Jesus, we lift our hearts before you, my God.
In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let us be in the mood of worship to worship the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the I Am That I Am, the Omnipotent, the Omniscience, the Giver of Life, the Living Water, the Bread of Life, the Manna of Heaven. Do something new in my life. Do something new in my life. Do something new in my life. Something new in my life.
Sometimes we are so moved by crowd, and so when we don't see the crowd, we don't feel easy. We don't feel ourselves. But you know, you were talking about the preacher who went to preach to the in the bush, in that old school. I remember when I was growing up in the faith in the city of London, I was preaching to my chairs in my room. I was the member of the church in my room. My chairs were my members, and I was there. I would put the CD in the music thing and I would dance to it and I would take the mic and my Bible and I would preach to my chest. So this is crowd. Hallelujah.
Amen. Okay, right?
So I think sometimes we get so caught up in the crowd to speak that we miss out on what God wants to do. Hallelujah. You know, when we stand before people, by the grace of God, I've stood before a lot of people and spoken in things. But God taught me that even if you are standing in the midst of thousands of people, you are speaking to individuals. Hallelujah.
Amen.
And if a preacher fails to realize that, then he or she is moved by crowd. So when you come to a place where you don't see crowd, you are unmoved or you feel like you are out of place. But I'm in the right place.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
I'm in the right place and you know why.
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. Are you going to record what we are going to do?
Yeah.
Okay. And if you don't mind, we'll do like a Bible study. So can we come a little closer and sit together so we can talk? And I will, Mama, I hope it's okay to not use the pulpit but stand right here.
Okay.
I'm very, very comfortable.
Okay.
Just so you know, I am very comfortable tonight. We thank God for Pastor and what God is using him to do. Hallelujah. You know, personally, every day, every opportunity I get to be with him, he come by, you know, the bank sometime briefly, and I get the opportunity to kind of like, you know, engage him a little bit. Every time he come by the bank, there's one thing I always do. I always make sure that at least I will have him speak a word. And I always say, man of God, please, you can't just leave without going to decree something. Hallelujah. And so, but I also know that his ministry is not just to this geographical location. You listen to the type of prophetic words that God uses him to make. He's not one of those prophets who are called to the local assembly or to the local environment. He's one of those people God is calling to the nations. So please, be ready for the times when God will be away from here. It's possible, a time is coming, he will go for extended period of time. But the base must be here. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
The base must always be where? Here.
Yeah.
But this is where God is also calling all of us. One of the things, I used to, when I was growing up, one of the scriptures they will reference all the time is a virtuous woman who can find. You know, when brothers are praying, or they want to pass comments about sister, they say, a virtuous woman who can find. The one day I was reading through the Bible says that who can find a faithful man? So then I'll go to these meetings and, you know, when we're growing, we'll go to church and then they say, you come and lead us to pray. So this one come and lead us to pray and sometimes some of them will stand there and then they'll bash. You can hear that. You know that they are talking to some people. A virtuous man who can find. Pray that God will give you virtuous men. And one day they gave me the mic and I stood and said, God said, who can find a faithful man? And then the place went. But for me, it changed my life. Because faithfulness actually comes in the absence of a leader. Today, I didn't go to work. In fact, I'm not going there until Wednesday. There are those who think the cat is out, so the mouse is at liberty. And then there are those who will say that because he's not here, I am going to make sure that everything go according to his expectations. So when you come, you'll be pleased. So you always have those kinds of people. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Mama, we preachers, some of us, we come to a point where we are not moved by crowd. But I've also realized that now even our congregants are more moved by crowd than preachers. So now congregants come to church, they don't see the crowd. Is everything okay? And they begin to look out the door, and every second they are looking to see somebody else is coming. The most important thing is that you are here.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Amen. So I'm going to speak as though there are thousands of people here.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Yes. So please come with me in your Bible to the book of Joshua. The book of Joshua. Hallelujah. The book of Joshua. Joshua chapter 7. I'll make references to some of the previous chapters and stuff, but Joshua chapter 7. We'll read from verse number 10 through verse number 13. Hallelujah. Are we together?
Yeah.
All right. Bible says that. Are we all there? Joshua chapter 7. Okay. Verse 10. Bible says that. So the Lord said to Joshua, "Get up. Why do you lie thus on your face?" Now, let me stop for a second. If you know the scriptures well, you know the children of Israel and their customs and their things. When the man goes there and put his face to the ground all day, it means the person is fasting. Fasting and praying. Waiting on God for a word from God. So this is what Joshua and the people have been doing, because for the first time they have been defeated during the battle. A small nation, a small island, a small people by the name of Ai has defeated them. In fact, when they did their military exercise and they spied out the place, the report they brought to Joshua, of course, was the commander and the leader. The report they brought to Joshua is that these people are small. This nation is small. We don't need a whole army to go up against them. You have to understand, by this time, Israel have defeated the Canaanites, are doing exploits. And so they said to Joshua, only about 2,000 soldiers can destroy these people. So let us go and just, you know, this is just a routine, a process. So let us go and just go through the motions and you know, settle this score and move on. Because there are better, bigger and better work ahead of us. This is a small work. But surprisingly, to their amazement, they go and then they are defeated. They run. In fact, about 34 of them were actually slain, and the rest will run away. And so when they came to Joshua was, of course, he had just taken over from Moses. So his leadership has not yet been cemented in the eyes of the people. They were still coming to terms with his personal leadership. And so for him, this is his first crisis. Of course, when he was with Moses, he experienced all the crises that Moses went through. But at that time, you see, when you are the assistant or you are the armor bearer, what your leader faces, even though you feel it, you only feel it in a minute sense, because it is not, so to speak, your battle. But you are part of the supporting cast. But really, it is not your battle. So for Joshua, this is his first real test as a leader. And so he went to God in prayer. And in verse, when you read from verse 10, Bible, that God came to Joshua. And God said to Joshua, "So the Lord said to Joshua, 'Get up. Why do you lie thus on your face? Israel has sinned, and they have also transgressed my covenant, which I commanded them. For they have taken some of the accursed things, and have both stolen and deceived, and they have also put it among their own stuff. Therefore, the children of Israel could not stand before their enemies, but turn their backs before their enemies, because they have become doomed to destruction. Neither will I be with you anymore, unless you destroy the accursed thing from among you. Get up, sanctify the people, and say, sanctify yourselves for tomorrow, because thus says the Lord God of Israel, there is an accursed thing in your midst. Oh Israel, you cannot stand before your enemies until you have taken away the accursed things
from you. Hallelujah. Father, bless your word as we break bread tonight. I ask that revelation and it will flow through me unhindered. I plead the blood of Jesus over my lips. I plead the blood of Jesus over my mind. I ask that you sanctify my mind and let the words that come out of this vessel be the word of God in Jesus' mighty name. Bible says that words that are fitly spoken are like golden apples in a settings of silver. I pray tonight that my word, my God, will bring invigorating to somebody. I pray tonight, my God, that you will bypass my mental weakness, oh God, and speak through this vessel to your people. Bible says, my God, in 2 Corinthians, that we have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellency and the power will be of God and not of us. I pray tonight that they will discern that this indeed is God speaking to them and not man. I empty myself of everything that is called self, and I pray that as I abase, you will abound. As I decrease, you will increase in me. Yes, Lord, I stand in need of you. Like John the Baptist, I testify that a man can receive nothing unless it has been given to him from above. And so even as Jeremiah said that the word of the Lord came to me, Isaiah also said that the word of the Lord came to me, and Ezekiel said that the word of the Lord came to me. Tonight, let your word come to me for your people, and let your word transform our lives in Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah. Of course, if you know the story, before they went to face the people of Ai, before they fought the Canaanites, God gave them specific instructions to Joshua, through Joshua. And when they were going to fight, when you go to chapter 6 from verse number 18, Joshua had given specific instructions to them. And in verse 18 of Joshua chapter 6, Joshua said to them, "And you, by all means, abstain from the accursed things, lest you become accursed when you take of the accursed things and make the camp of Israel a curse and trouble it." Hallelujah. Here's one thing I've learned about life, beloved. I have learned that there are things that are accursed things, even in the house of God. For example, the tithe is an accursed money. It's money that is, when you touch it, you invite curses on yourself. Check your Bible very well. When you touch the tithe, you touch an accursed thing. And scripture says that when you touch an accursed thing, you become cursed. And when you become cursed, you bring curse to the environment you operate in. So one of the biggest challenges in life is that when you find yourself in a place where there is the accursed, then the ground becomes very hard. The heavens become like a brass and the ground becomes very hard. It's like you are planted on a concrete floor. Nothing is going to grow. Hallelujah. And so Joshua was very specific in his instructions to the people of Israel. I was talking to Pastor Prophet Austin the other day, I think last week. He was in my office and there was something we're doing. We're talking briefly. I said, "Man of God, I've learned that our ability," I said to him, "that the problem with black people, including myself, the biggest problem, whether you are African-American, African, whoever, whatever kind of black you are, that our biggest problem is our inability to follow instructions." Yes. Unfortunately, this is also prevalent in the church. In the church of God, people don't follow instructions. And as a result of that, there are so many. So we are praying, we are not seeing results. We are fasting and we are praying. We are doing everything we can. The word of God is decreeing. He sees what God is saying. He declared the word of God. But we are not seeing anything. Not because God is incapable, but the man of God did not see right. But because of our inability to follow instructions. If you want to be successful in life, you have to learn to follow instructions. Hallelujah.
Amen.
In 2007, Marion Jones, the United States sprint athlete, was sentenced to prison for 6 months for, among other things, lying to federal grand jury or federal officers. You know, in the United States, when they use the word federal, it means you are dealing with the force of the nation, because this is a nation ruled by law. So when you go against the law of the land, you are going against the very, it's like going against God. Because the law is the supreme. The constitution is the supremacy of the nation. The president and everybody is subjected to the constitution. So in America, the constitution is the main deal. And so, Marianne Jones in 2000 took part in the Olympic Games in Australia. At the end of the Olympic Games, Marianne Jones was the most decorated athlete at the time. Came out with 5 medals from the Olympic Games. Among other things, 100 meters, 200 meters, 4 by 100 meters, the 4 by 400 meters, she was decorated. And then she had a bronze in a long jump. So Marianne Jones was the darling of the United States. The whole world, we all clap and we stand in awe of Marianne Jones because we saw that she was doing something that was not common. But years after that, news began to surface that she had used banned substances. Her performance was tainted by some substances that she has been told not to use, because when you use those substances, you get an advantage over your opponents. And in a spirit of fairness, you cannot gain advantage over other people by reason of using substances that improves your performances. Now, among other things, all the medals she won was recalled. They recalled those medals. And then they also recall the medals of the four, the team sport, you know, the format, the relay. The relay is when 4 people are running. And they requested for those medals. And when they requested for those medals, the people who were part of the 4 by 100 meters relay team said that they don't want to give the medals back because they competed fairly. They were tested after the Olympics and they were found not to have taken any substances. Marianne Jones joined the games, was not found to have taken anything. So as far as they were concerned, they have done nothing wrong. And the Olympic Committee responded to them and said, "We are asking you to retain the medals, not because of what you have done, but because of who you did it with. So the reason why you need to retain your medals is not because you have done something wrong, but the person who was with you did something wrong." Hallelujah. And so tonight, like the Olympics, my title is, "Who are you running with?" Hallelujah. Amen. Who are you running with? Amen.
Amen.
Now, the scriptures we are reading about the defeat at Ai, we are not told that Achan was part of the people who went to fight the people of Ai. We know that he was part of the people who went in to Jericho to fight. But whilst he was in Jericho fighting, he saw things. In fact, let's just go to that scripture just so that, let me lay a good foundation so I can press on. Look at chapter 7, and let me take you all the way to from verse number 20. I'll read from verse 19 for the sake of clarity. Joshua chapter 7 from verse 19. "Now Joshua said to Achan, 'My son, I beg you, give glory to the Lord God of Israel and make confession to him. And tell me now what you have done. Do not hide it from me.' And Achan answered Joshua and said, 'Indeed, I have sinned against the Lord God of Israel, and this is what I have done. When I saw,'" please mark the words very carefully, "'when I saw among the spoils, a beautiful Babylonian garment, 200 shekels of silver, and a wedge of gold weighing 50 shekels, I coveted them and took them. And here they are hidden in the earth, in the midst of my tent, with the silver under it.' So Joshua sent messengers and they ran to the tent, and there it was hidden in his tent with the silver under it. And they took them from the midst of the tent, brought them to Joshua and to all the children of Israel," and then the rest you can read. Hallelujah. The point is this. When they went to Jericho, Specifically, instructions were given that do not take anything of the land except the silver and the gold, which are intended to be taken to the house of God, sanctified for God, not for us. And you shall not touch anything of that land to take of yourself. Unknown to Joshua and all the people of Israel, Achan saw, he said, I saw. Bible says, do not love the world, nor the things of the world. I am speaking to you tonight. I said that who is running with you? Who is in your team? Who is with you? Who among your friends? And I'm speaking about the people around you. Because, Mama, one of the things I've learned is that God answers prayers. Prayer works. However, there are things we do, no matter how much we pray, no matter how powerful the minister, it will come to naught. Not because the man of God is not powerful, not because God cannot come through for us, but because of our own decisions and our actions. We can undo everything God has done for us. Hallelujah. Amen. And so Achan said to them, when I saw, I took. He said, I saw among the spoils a Babylonian garment, 200 shekels of silver, and a wedge of gold weighing 50 shekels. I coveted them. I coveted them. Hallelujah. Amen. He said, I coveted. Bible says, thou shalt not covet. He coveted them. And as a result of that, the whole nation goes to battle and they lose, not because they are not capable, not because God was not with them, but because they have obeyed, they have disobeyed a divine instructions, not because all the congregation disobeyed one man. All it takes is one person to ruin everything that we have been working for years. One person will ruin everything that you work for all your life. Let me give you an example. When Jonah wanted to go away from God because he didn't want to go to Nineveh to preach, because he didn't want those people there to be saved, and he decided, God said, go east, he went west. God said, go by land, he went by sea. And then there was a chaos, storms arose on the ocean, and they threw away everything. You got to understand, these were merchants, business people doing their business. In those days, when you are able to travel by sea or by rivers or whatever, you are very rich. These are business moguls. And they lost everything because they had to do everything to try to save their lives. And while they were trying to, they threw away all the cargo that was on the ship, doing everything they can to sustain the ship. Bible said that Jonah had gone down to the bottom and was fast asleep. The commotion and the chaos that was going on, he was oblivious to. People were losing their lifetime of investment, and yet the culprit had gone down into the sea, into the boat, and was fast asleep. Beloved, who in your life, who has come into your life, and he or she is the cause of your challenges? How many demons are in your home? Every day you cast demons. How many are in your home? Since you became a Christian, you've been binding and binding and binding. So how many demons are there in your home that every time you bind them? Even your own nation, if you are binding them, by this time, because Bible says one will chase 1,000, two chase 10,000. So when we all come together and we're praying, and we say, let's bind them, and there are more than two of us, that means just the two, by reason of multiplication, over 10,000 have been cast out. So all these years you'll be saved. If we are casting out demons together, how many are left? Surely by this time, even if your whole nation are demons, they should all be gone by now. But sometimes it's not the demons. David said, it was not an enemy who has risen up against me. He said, then I could have bear it. He said, a man, we took counsel together. The one who is undoing me is the one that I took counsel together. He said, we went to the house of God together. We took counsel. We planned together. He was the one who was undoing me. Hallelujah. Beloved, who are the anchors in your life? And so Israel is defeated in battle for the first time. Joshua's leadership is facing its first crisis, not because Joshua was making wrong decisions, not because the elders of Israel were making wrong decisions, but because one man went to war and decided to go against the instructions that they were given. And as a result of that, by his disobedience, he brought upon the whole nation defeat. And you have to understand this, please. Listen, military speaking, if that defeat had remained, if God had not intervened and they have gone back, the people from Jericho would have gathered themselves and come back to fight. All the other nations they destroyed would have come back to fight them and would have wiped them out. Why? Because whilst you remain, you are a threat. Whilst you remain, you are a threat. Think about it for a second. Let me pause for you to process this. One man in your life, one person, unknown to the leadership, one person decide to go against the instructions and brings calamity upon the whole people. One person. But one man's disobedient, like Adam. Bible said, by one man's disobedience, sin came into the world. But thank God about through one man's obedience, life was brought back. Amen. But think about this. One person goes to battle, decide to go against the instructions, and he exposes. Look at what God said to Joshua. Let's go back to from verse 10. Look at from verse number 13. God said, get up, sanctify the people, and say to them, sanctify yourself for tomorrow, because that says the Lord God of Israel, there is an accursing in your midst. And now look at what God says. Oh Israel, you cannot stand before your enemies until you take away the accursed thing from among you. Hallelujah. Look at verse 12. God said to Joshua in verse 12, therefore the children of Israel could not stand before their enemies, but turn their backs before their enemies, because they have become doomed. God says, by reason of this disobedience, you have become doomed to destructions. In other words, now you are exposed to destruction. So unless imminent action is taken, the whole people are subject to destruction. Think about it for a second. One man's disobedience. The whole nation was at risk. God said, you are doomed to destruction. Hallelujah. You are doomed to destruction. And then he says to them again, neither will I be with you anymore unless you take your casting. So not only are they doomed to destroy. Listen to me. Before the enemy can get to you, God will have to take himself away or give him permission to. What did Jesus say concerning Peter? He said, Peter, the enemy has sought you to sift you like wheat. But I pray for the enemy has desired, sought for you. In other words, Satan has asked for permission to your name. But I pray for you that when you return, restore your fellows. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Please, who is running with you? Who is running with you? Not too long ago, I was doing a message at this pastor friend of mine's church. And my title was, who are you listening to? Who is running with you tonight? Who is in your life? Who is causing all the chaos? Who is running with you? Who is running with you? Hallelujah. Who is running with you? Hallelujah.
Amen.
See, I made some notes. I said that Achan's actions brought about military defeat. That could have brought unnecessary challenge on the people. There is something we call unintended consequences. Let me get closer to you. To every cause, they tell us that the law of the universe, they tell us that to every cause, there is an effect. Now, I've learned that what I have control of is the cause, but I have no control over the effect of the cause. So if I set something in motion, it keeps going. However, In the midst of the cause and the effect, there is also what we call the unintended consequences. Unintended consequences of your action is, I did this. I wasn't expecting that, but that happened. We call it unintended consequences. See, when Achan, I don't believe that he thought that what he was doing was going to be detrimental to the nation. Maybe he didn't know. But I know that there was something in him. I call it the terminal tendencies. And we all have them. Terminal tendencies are things in you that can potentially destroy things. There are some habits, there are some behaviors in all of us, in the inside of us, that if we leave them unchecked, they can undo us in our lives. I don't believe that he knew the consequences of what he was doing. I don't believe that he thought about the consequences of whatever he was taking, what the implication to the people. I don't think he knew that. But the unintended consequences of his action was that he brought defeat on the whole people. And the first crisis in Joshua's leadership. Hallelujah.
Amen.
To every cause, there is an effect. Tendencies is a part. They said that tendency is the part of your character that makes you often behave in an unpleasant or worrying ways. Not all the time, but sometimes. A part of you. David had that. David's terminal tendencies was his weakness to women. Remember even when he became old, and I'm not blaspheming, but I remember when he became old as a king and he was near the end of his life and he was very cold. What did they do? They brought a young woman. You think they didn't know who he was? At the time kings goes to war, David was on his rooftop looking around and he saw what if he had gone to battle he wouldn't see. That was his terminal tendency. Saul had a terminal tendency. Saul's terminal tendency was that insecurity that was in himself. A leader who is insecure is a very dangerous leader. Because you can never predict what they will do next. So you can never trust an unpredictable leader. Terminal tendencies. What are your own terminal tendencies? Mama, I've learned that we can pray all the prayers. We can do all those things. And God answers prayers. But there comes a time when our terminal tendencies, these tendencies in us, will derail everything God desire to do in our lives. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So how do you identify an Achan? I have to talk about that. How do you identify them? Because the sad thing is that they are all around us. Some of them, they meant well. They don't mean evil. They mean well. But there are unintended consequences of their actions. So they mean well, however. Hallelujah.
Amen.
They mean well. The people on the ship, if they knew Jonah when he was coming, if they knew who he was, that if they knew that this is a vagabond running away from God, I'm sure the captain would have said to him that no, there's no way you enter this ship. There is no way. So there are times, mama, there are times people come into our life, they are running from God. And we too, sometimes we are quick to want to help people whom we shouldn't help because God is dealing with them. Sometimes God wants to teach people certain life skills, certain life principles. Sometimes God wants to teach people to trust Him. And Lord, He removes all their security from them, take away everything they can lean on so that all they will have is God. And yet we are willing to support. And so we take away the grace that God wants to develop in them. Hallelujah. Even when it comes to help, we got to be careful. Even help, you must be careful. Who you provide help to? A few years ago, I was in the city of London. I was talking to my senior brother. And we have a cousin. And my brother was telling me that he traveled to Africa and he blessed him. And he said, Richie, when I came back, I struggled financially. Then he went back to Ghana again. The same thing happened. We have there's a lot of pastors in my home. And by the grace of God, of course. And one of them was telling my senior brother that this young lady, she's good. But in her home, there are forces battling her. So when you do something good to her, they fight. So by doing a person good, you force them to come after you. I can imagine, Mama. I can imagine. Listen, Bible says that the tender mercies of the enemy is cruelty. Satan's tender mercies is cruel. When he's being cruel, that's his tender mercy. So imagine, when he's not showing tender mercies, his tender mercies is cruelty. So when he's not showing tender mercy, hallelujah. So how do we identify the acorns? How would you know that this is an acorn? And please, don't go around pointing and saying, this is an acorn. This one, yeah, I'm not saying that. Hallelujah. I have to make that clear. No, I have to. So we don't go around, hey, this one's an acorn. Let me go this way. Hey, this one's an acorn. No. That's not what it's about. We don't want that. We don't want that. Hallelujah. There's righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. That's the kingdom of God. Please. I'm not saying we should go around fishing for Jesus said fish for men. We are not instructed to go and fish for acorns. The first thing that helps you to identify that somebody is an acorn is that they are disobedient and they don't follow orders. So how do you identify an acorn? Number one, they are disobedient and they don't follow instructions. Watch those people. They are very dangerous. They are very, very, very dangerous. Everybody is subject to somebody. And a man's inability or a man's hesitation to take instructions and to act on instructions and be obedient is a sign of a vagabond. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So a person who is disobedient, you want to be very careful. I'm not saying pray for them. Pray for them. They are disobedient, they don't follow instructions. You want to be careful of them. Hallelujah. Such people, please, be very careful. Be very, very careful with such people. Me, we come from Africa, so this is very common. You know that Africans are very, especially those who are privileged to be in this part of the world, how they criticize our leaders back home in Africa. Now, please don't get me wrong. I know that things they do there that are very bad. Some things are very, very bad. However, as a child of God, I know that the instruction of God is that thou must not speak evil of your ruler, of the ruler of your people. So you cannot tell me you are spirit-filled and you can stand and talk anyhow at our leaders. No matter how you feel, there has to be something in you that checks you, that put brakes on you, because you are dealing with forces you have no idea of. What if whatever the person is doing, it is God's hand? God said, Pharaoh, for this reason, I created you. I may show forth my power in all the earth. What if? Now, you have to understand that there were 10 plagues. Every one of those plagues was an attack against one of the Egypt. Egypt had 10 gods at the time they fellowship, they worship. And every one of those plagues was an attack on one of them. Now, if God didn't raise up Pharaoh, how will God defeat those gods? You must understand that anything that calls itself God, he or she is at war with God. Oh, yeah. In the olden days, there's only one king who will rule the whole world. You may have your sub-kings, but there's always going to be the one, like Artaxerxes, in the days of Daniel, in the days of Nehemiah. Like Pharaoh, there were other gods, but Pharaoh was the top dog in those days. When Joseph got to Egypt, Pharaoh was the top dog. It was the United States of America at the time. So there were other nations, but there were ones that were more superior in their military power, in their economies and things like that. In the United States, like right now in this country. So how would God know? For example, we know that they had the sun god, Ra. So what God brought the darkness, what God was saying was that, let Ra give you light and we will see. You go up, listen, there are certain things when you go after God himself. Disobedience is one of the most heinous things in the eyes of God. Samuel looked at Saul in the eyes and he said, does God value obedience? More, and he said, does not value obedience or sacrifice. And he said, behold, to obey is better than sacrifice. And to heed instructions, better. And he said, because it is as a sin of witchcraft. So, how would you know an egg can watch the way they behave? Do they tone the line, or they always want to be the one? Now, I'm not saying that we should not ask questions. We must ask questions. Sometimes when we are asked to do certain things, we must ask questions. Sometimes to clarify, sometimes to make sense to yourself, so you know what you are doing. Hallelujah. But then there are also those who are blatantly disobedient and will not follow instructions. Be careful of those people. Because some people in your lives will delay your blessings. And I stand here and I speak as a man of God. Such people in your life will delay your blessing. Time will fill me for me to tell you about David's son, Amnon. He had a friend called Jonadab. When this guy was lusting after his half-sister, his friend came, Jonadab came and gave him advice and pretend to be sick. And when your father comes to visit you, tell him that your sister Tamar should be sent to come and cook for you. And when she cooks, ask her to bring the food to you in a room. And when she comes, force her and sleep with her. And he did that. It was his friend who advised him to do that. His friend's name was Jonadab. Who are the Jonadabs in your life? Hallelujah. The second thing is, they are envious and they are jealous. Achans are always envious and they are jealous. Watch them. They have all everything. If you show up in a watch, just a simple wristwatch, that probably you bought from the dollar store, even that they want it. And you can tell what envy people, because they will go and get one, they will wear it today, they will wear it tomorrow, and then they will leave it. They will leave it. And they go and get more. Because they are envious. So every time they see someone with something, their eyes tell them, go and get one. So they are always poor. And they are always borrowing money. So they borrow money to buy things they don't need, to try to impress people who don't even care. I don't even remember what I wore to church last Sunday. I don't remember what I wore to church last Sunday for me to think about what you were wearing. Watch them. They are envious and they are jealous. Watch them. The third thing is that you help you to identify Achans is the Gehazi spirit. The Gehazi spirit. The prophet said to Naaman, take your belongings with you. Take all the gift you brought. Take everything with you. Go back to your land. When he left, Gehazi ran after him. I said, oh, my master said, and he took it and he came and hid it. Be careful of those people. The Gehazi spirit. Some people call Gehazi. Be careful with Gehazi. Be careful with the Gehazis in your life. Be careful with them. Hallelujah. Amen. The fourth thing I want to say to you is that be very discerning. Let me show you a scripture. Come with me, please, to Proverbs chapter 12. Proverbs chapter 12. Verse number 26. Proverbs 12, verse 26. Hallelujah. Are we there? Yes. What does the Bible say? He says, let the righteous choose his friends carefully. Why? Because for us the way of the wicked, for the ways of the wicked will lead them astray. Let the righteous choose his friends carefully. The way I rephrase that scripture is this. If you're a man, look at the way you took your time to search for a wife. If you're a woman, look at how you took time to pray for your life partner. Why is it that a friend, you don't want to pray to have a friend? There are different kinds of friends. Please. Bible said, let the righteous choose his friends carefully. Why? Because the wicked will lead him astray. So the Achans will lead you astray. So be very careful. Choose your friends carefully. Not everybody in the church is a friend. Not everybody in the church. Listen, we are commanded to love everybody. We are not commanded to trust anybody. Show me where the scripture said, besides God, who said, trust me. In fact, he has said that cursed is the man who put his trust in a fellow man. Jeremiah chapter 17. God himself has said that. The only thing we are commanded to do is to love all. He said, love one another. He didn't say, I command you to trust one another. No. So he says, let the righteous choose his friends carefully. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Let us be very careful in how we choose friends. Let us be very careful how we choose. So how do we identify those acres? Number one, disobedient. Disobedient. Number two, envious. Number three, the Gehazi spirit, greed. Is in them greed. The Gehazi spirit is a greed. They are greedy for gain. Greed. The pastor can't, they want to be like the pastor. The pastor shows up wearing a suit. They want to be like, there was a man in my church. It got to a point, the wife was getting ready to divorce him because they were very broke. And why? His motivation, the wife was complaining, he's always buying new suits. Not knowing that, every day he sees a pastor come and stand there in a new suit, he's going to buy a new suit. So, how can you, people are blessing the man of God with the suit, and you go and you buy. That's the difference. Somebody blesses a man of God, you go and buy. So, he's sitting in a church, but unconsciously, he's competing on dressing. Sometimes they are part of leadership. They want to usurp authority. That's what Satan did. And he was thrown out from heaven. Greed. He wants it. Do you know what we go through? God sent a prophet to go and marry a prostitute. She will go back into prostitution. God will tell you, go and bring her back. And in those days, when they do their thing, they call them brothels. And at the brothels, everybody sees them. And here's a prophet, seasoned man of God. God said, marry her. Bring her home. Her name was Goma. They have a child. She will leave the child and go back into prostitution. God said, go back and bring her. Do you know who I'm talking about, right? Hosea, the prophet. Can you imagine that? Can you see yourself? Can you imagine Pastor coming and saying, God says, in fact, let me give you a simple one. Timothy, Paul said to Timothy, drink a little wine for your stomach's sake. Suppose you open that door, go to pastor's office, and he's sleeping a little wine. These days, you know orange juice, when you put them in glasses, it looks like wine.
Yeah.
These days, if you're a man of God and you're not careful, and you know these days, they come and sit in church with their phones. They will take a picture and they put it on Facebook before. How would you defend that? That orange juice, apple juice, and not. How would you even defend that? Hallelujah. How would you even defend that? Oh, Jesus. And so, but all they see is when you stand here and you do what you do. And so they think they can become. And so they run ahead to try to become. Greed. The Gehazi spirit. Please. Watch out for those people. Please. There will be the difference between an answered prayer and a delivered blessing. Hallelujah.
Amen.
May I believe in the word. Jesus said, you are clean because of the word I've spoken to you. The word of God has power to deliver.
Amen.
The word of God has power to save.
Amen.
The word of God has power to transform.
Amen.
Who are you running with? The Olympic Committee said to those three wonderful sisters that we are stripping you of your Olympic gold medals, not because you did something wrong, but because of who was running with you. Who is running with you tonight as I bring my message to a close? Who is running with you? Hallelujah.
Amen.
And whilst I'm on the subject, let me also speak to you who are here. let us also search for ourselves. And if perhaps we are Gehazi, we are Achan's or Gehazi's, let us, or Jonas, let us ask God to deliver us. Hallelujah. Let's stand to our feet, please. Oh, Jesus, deliver us tonight. Save us tonight. Heal us tonight. Please, you've heard the word of God. You've heard the word of God. Speak to 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 God. I don't believe that as a man of God today, I spoke, I threw seeds onto rocky grounds or by the wayside of it. I believe that I threw seed to the fertile ground in the name of Jesus. Oh, Lord Jesus, we thank you. Father, 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 we thank you tonight. We thank you. Mighty God, we thank you tonight. We thank you for your word. 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 We thank you, Father. We thank you. My God, we pray tonight as we go to our beds. Tonight as we lay on our beds to sleep. My God, tonight, whether we are going to work, whether we are going home, I pray that at some point tonight, my God, you will arrest, my God, our attention, my God. You will get our attention and, my God, begin to show us, my God, in our own lives, any acres in our lives, my God, in the name of Jesus. Any acres in our lives, any acres in our lives. Thank you, thank you, thank you, Lord. Show us any acres in our lives, my God. But we ourselves, my God, open our eyes to see. Let us see ourselves. Bible says, try me, test me, and know. Try me, and know me. Try me, and know me. And see if there be any wicked way in me. Tonight, we pray in the name of Jesus Christ, that Lord, you will look into our hearts, and if there be any acres in us, if there is any ounce of acorn in me, Lord, I pray in the name of Jesus. I pray it out of me in the name of Jesus. I pray it out of me in the name of Jesus. I pray it out of me in the name of Jesus. Ah, let your name be glorified. Let your name be glorified. King of kings and Lord of lords, let your name be glorified. Let your awesome name be glorified. Let your mighty name be glorified. Let your majestic name be glorified. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, 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 in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. We're praying our soul that there's some people, I don't know, but it seems like there's somebody here. If you will critically look into your life and the people in your life, somebody came into your life, life has never been the same. Somebody came into your life, at some point, things have never been the same. Challenge after challenge after challenge. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Tonight, Father, we pray for courage and boldness to root out certain relationships, amen, toxic relationships in our lives. We root them out. We root them out. We root them out. We root them out. In this church, in a toxic relationship, we rule it out in the name of Jesus. We rule it out in the name of Jesus. We uproot them. We burn them to fire. We burn them with fire. We burn them with fire. We uproot them and burn them with fire in the name of Jesus. In our lives. Finally, I want you to pray and ask God, Lord, if anyone is seeking to come into my life because of where you are taking me, who is an acorn, who is going to derail, who is going to frustrate your plans, your purpose for my life, Lord, let me know. I told you that one of the things you do is that you discern relationships. Ask God to upgrade your discernment, to upgrade your ability to discern. No matter how much promises they made to you, if something is not of God, it is not of God. If it is not of God, it is not of God. If it is not of God, it is not of God. No matter how much much promises they make to you, lift up your voice and pray and say, Lord, give me the grace, the wisdom, my God, to fish them out. My God, the grace to identify them in the name of Jesus. The grace to identify them. We give you thanks. 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 You reveal to redeem. We give you thanks. We give you thanks. We give you thanks. My God, increase, upgrade our discernment. My God, upgrade our ability to discern. Upgrade our ability to discern in the name of Jesus. We give you thanks. I will give you thanks. And so, Father, I thank you tonight for the privilege to stand before your sons and daughters to bring your word, broken bread with you tonight. Bible says that you hasten your word to perform. We pray in Jesus' name that what this word is intended for in our lives at such a time as this, it will accomplish it in the name of Jesus. We give you thanks. We give you praise. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Are we blessed tonight? If you are blessed, shout a powerful hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
A victorious hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Amen. I want us to stretch our hands to the man of God. That let God continue to honor his words in his life. That God should continue to endow him with wisdom, with knowledge, and understanding. The glory of God should not depart from him. He has watered us tonight. Let God also water him. Let God replenish him. Let God fill him up with his power, with his anointing, with his strength, with his zeal to move on. In the name of Jesus. Father, I pray for your son tonight. Lord, begin to take him to a greater height. Lord, begin to multiply him. Enlarge his coast, oh God. Let your anointing be unction to function. Lord, endow him with him in the name of Jesus. Right from today, he has honored you. Ancient of days, I am that I am. Honor your words in his life in the name of Jesus. God of suddenly, Lord, answer him by fire in the name of Jesus. In Jesus' name we pray. I want us to pray for him once again. Today is his birthday. Like, let God bless his new age today. He has added another year to his life today, right from today, a turning point that would make the world ask, "Where take me to your God?" A miracle that will shake in his life. Let us just point and talk to God about his life, that God should bless his new age. God should move him to a new realm of glory. A new realm of glory, a new realm of success, a new realm of prosperity. I decree to your life today, because God has added another year to your life, the glory of God will continue to multiply upon your life in the name of Jesus. The Lord God will continue to protect you. Where you didn't expect, God will visit you. The Lord will surprise you, will grant you according to your heart's desire. The God of suddenly that we serve on this mountain will visit you. Your birthday gift within a space of 24 hours, the ancient of days, I am that I am, will give it to you. In the name of Jesus, helpers from the west, from the east, from the north will locate you. Wherever your helpers may be, the Lord will make them to meet with you in the name of Jesus. The glory of God will continue to radiate upon you, upon your family in the name of Jesus. God will continue to supply your needs. He will continue to take you a greater height. All over the whole world it shall be announced. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Let us talk to God quietly and say, Father Lord, every unfriendly friend in my life, Lord, separate me from them tonight in the name of Jesus. Every unfriendly friend in my life that is moving me away from you, that wants me to derail, that wants me to backslide away from you, Lord, move them away from me in the name of Jesus. Every unfriendly friend in my life, Lord, depart me from them in the name of Jesus. Separate me from them in the mighty name of Jesus. Unfriendly friend that would want me to move in the wrong direction, in the wrong way, Lord, separate me from them tonight in the name of Jesus. Separate me from them tonight in the name of Jesus. In Jesus' name we pray. In Jesus' name we pray. Let us listen to this announcement. Tomorrow there's a wedding here tomorrow by 2 p.m. We should all endeavor to come here. And also next week, Tuesday to Sunday, there will be a program which says the perfection of Able God. And I pray the Lord will visit us in the name of Jesus. And our Sunday service starts by 9 o'clock too, we should all endeavor to come early. Let us talk to God quietly. Lord, I'm leaving. Visit me tonight in the name of Jesus. Let me have an encounter with you tonight in the name of Jesus. Lord, visit me. Turn my situation around in the name of Jesus. I am that I am. Visit me tonight in the name of Jesus. Let me have a divine encounter with you tonight in the name of Jesus. Lord, I'm looking upon you. Father, ancient of days, I am that I am. Do that which you alone can do in my life in the name of Jesus. In Jesus' name we pray. In Jesus' name we pray. If we have any offering, we can drop it on the altar. Let us share the grace. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the sweet presence of Holy Spirit rest and abide with us now and forevermore. Amen. Surely, goodness and mercy shall follow us all the days of our lives, and we shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever and ever. Amen. Praise the Lord. Seven wonderful. Hallelujah.
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 Amen.
Thank you so much.
What's your name?
Happy birthday, sir.
Something hold me back. You know, I was going to Office Max to do some scanning and submit my own. So I
went
to get to the office, but I just said, let me just drive. And if you knew that you're not even here, you know that I'm going to the happy birthday.
Elijah!